And I will try to. Oh, good. Recording progress. I say, got it. Let me see. Good. And I'm very happy for this opportunity to share this with you. It's a kind of a curvature flow, which is for Bakery-Emery curvature. And Bakery-Emery curvature is an analytic curvature notion on graphs, which you can define on Markov chains as well. So the idea of my talk, or maybe the content of my talks, let me see. Will have four parts. So I will start with introducing Bakery-Emery curvature on weighted graphs. And we'll also explain a little bit. This is, oh, what happened? Let me see. Now suddenly my screen went dark. Can anybody hear me? Let me see. No signal. Can you hear me still? It's strange that my screen suddenly went dark. Oh, that's really not good. Can you still hear me?
Yes.
Aha, now it's back. Now I'm back, sort of. I don't know what happened here. So a few, this is always this, like this, how to call it, the, this, when you are relying on technology sometimes. So let me see, view, and I do again enter full screen and hopefully, we are hopefully back. So I want to talk about Bakery-Emery curvature, which is an analytic curvature notion defined on graphs using the Laplacian, the graph Laplacian, or in the case of Markov chains, a generator of the Markov chain. And I will explain a little bit how this can be understood, and then also how it can be reformulated with help of linear algebra. And the first step of the reformulation will be to formulate it as a semi-definite programming problem. We will see that this Bakery-Emery curvature is a local curvature. You only need the two-ball around the vertex, the combinatorial two-ball around the vertex to decide what the vertex curvature is of this graph. So the Bakery-Emery curvature is a curvature defined on the vertices of the graph. And in the second step, I will explain how this Bakery-Emery curvature can be reformulated as a curve, as an eigenvalue problem involving a certain matrix, which has the size of the one ball. And this idea goes back, essentially, I think, to two different people. One was David Cushing from our group, but he's now a postdoc in Newcastle, but he was a postdoc in Durham some time ago. And we are working together, Shiping and Florentin Mönch and David Cushing and other people. And he had this idea how to formulate it as an eigenvalue problem. But independently, Viola Siconolfi had also this idea, and we both published it almost at the same time. I will sort of come to this in the second part of the talk. And once we have introduced sort of this Bakery-Emery curvature as an eigenvalue problem, which is easier to calculate than to find the right parameter in a semi-definite programming problem, I will then explain how this eigenvalue problem motivates to introduce a curvature flow. This curvature flow will be a kind of an evolution of the weights of this weighted graph. And I will talk a little bit about what is curvature flow, some basic properties, and at the end, after all the math has been finished, I will do some examples to illustrate it. So this will be the entertaining part at the end of the talk. Let me also mention that this talk is joint work with David Cushing from Newcastle University, Supanat Kamtue, who was a PhD student of mine and who is now in Tsinghua University, a postdoc, and then Shiping Yu from USDC, and Florentin Münch from MPI Leipzig, and Ben Snodgrass, who was the undergraduate student who implemented the curvature flow. So it was quite a group of people who came here together to introduce this curvature flow. Okay, and curvature flow obviously has been introduced for graphs in various curvature settings, and we will focus today on this Bakery-Emery curvature. So let me start explaining what this Bakery-Emery curvature is. So what's the setting? The setting is we start with a finite, simple means no multiple edges, no loops, mixed graph. What do I mean by mixed? By mixed, I mean that it can have one-sided edges and it can have two-sided edges. So the one-sided edges are collected in the set E1, and the two-sided edges are collected in the set E2. And on the right-hand side, there is an example. For example, the edge from Y to Z on the right-hand side is a one-sided edge. The green edges here are two-sided edges. So the one-sided edges have a direction, the two-sided edges don't have a direction. Once you have such a combinatorial object, which we call the topology of the underlying graph, of the weighted graph, then we can also introduce that distance function. And this distance function is defined to be the shortest directed path from a vertex to another vertex. So when you have two vertices, you are only allowed to walk, if you want to calculate the distance, you look at all paths from X to Y, but you're only allowed when there's a one-sided edge to go in the direction of the one-sided edge. For example, if we have X and Y, and we ask ourselves what's the distance, then we can follow from X all across, and this would be three edges, three double-sided edges, and you can't use the red edge here, which would be maybe distance two, because the second red edge from Z to Y goes in the wrong direction. And that is sort of the combinatorial, the topological sort of underbelly of such a weighted graph. And then the second ingredient is transition weights. So for every edge, one or two-sided, we have transition probabilities. And we they may be transition probabilities. One can also define them more generally as weights, but maybe for the sake of this talk, we assume maybe there would be so-called Markovian, which means we can think of these transition probabilities along the edges as probabilities of a random walk. And we also allow laziness or idleness. So for example, the vertex X here would have two edges emanating, one would have the probability 0.5 from X to the lower edge and 0.5 from X to the right. They add up to one. And so that would be sort of the transition probabilities adding up to one. And we don't have laziness because there's no positive probability for X to stay. And you can write these transition probabilities or transition weights via a matrix, which you call capital P. And the idea is you have only positive, potentially positive transition weights when there's an edge. If there's no edge, for example, between X and Y, there's no edge. Therefore, the transition probabilities in both directions, the transition weights would be zero. But it's not necessarily that the probability is, or that the transition weights are positive if there's an edge. Could also be zero. So we have two things, underlying combinatorial mixed graph and a matrix of transition weights. Okay, and then once you have this data, you can define the Laplacian, the graph Laplacian, which has this formula here on the right-hand side. It's a operator on functions on the vertices, and it's defined by this sum here, Pxy, f of y minus f of x. And so the idea is now to define a curvature, and the curvature notion which is here is going back to Baker-Emery, and they introduce this gamma calculus, which does the following. If you have two functions f and g, and then they introduce two bilinear operators. The first bilinear operator, 2 gamma f comma g, is you take Laplacian of the product minus f times Laplacian g minus g times Laplacian f. You see in this definition, the only ingredient is the Laplacian. You don't need any other operator in order to define gamma. And this can also be by a kind of partial integration be written as a sum on the right-hand side. And if you think about Laplacian, if it would be a first order differential operator, then this would be somehow measuring the deviation from satisfying the product rule. But Laplacian is second order, and therefore it's obviously not, it doesn't satisfy the product rule, and therefore this gamma is usually non-zero. It's even usually non-negative, because you see it on the right-hand side when you plug in the same function. So if you take f, f, then you get on the right-hand side Pxy f of y minus f of x squared, and this is non-negative. And then there's another operator, 2 gamma 2, which is defined via the gamma operator, and it's kind of an iteration of the gamma operator. Wherever you have a product, you look at the upper definition of the gamma bilinear operator, and whenever you have a product of two functions, you replace it by gamma of these two functions. For example, Laplacian of fg becomes Laplacian of gamma fg. F Laplacian g becomes gamma of f Laplacian g, and g Laplacian f becomes gamma g Laplacian f. And then you have two bilinear operators, and these two were introduced by Baker and Emery, the so-called gamma calculus. And now we can use these two operators, which are purely defined by the Laplacian, to define a curvature notion. And this will happen in the next slide. Okay, so how do we do this? So it's based on a fundamental identity in Riemannian geometry, which is called Buchner's Weizenbock formula, and this has many implications, vanishing of cohomologies, and so there's a really a very clear motivation for this identity. And one used this identity, reformulated this with gamma and gamma 2, and then one and this identity involves the Laplacian. The original identity involves Laplacian, Hessian, gradient, and Ricci curvature, but when we reformulate it as an inequality, we only have Laplacians and gamma and gamma 2, and everything is based on the Laplacian and Ricci curvature. And this identity sort of indirectly gives us information about the Ricci curvature on a Riemannian manifold, and now we do it the other way around. We use analytically the definition of the Laplacian to define Ricci curvature on a graph. And this goes as follows. We have a weighted graph. G is a topology. T is the weights. And we also have a dimension. Many people will ask what's the dimension of a graph. I can't answer this sort of somehow. You may have the feelings that the n-dimensional hypercube is dimension n. But in some sense, it's very difficult if I give you an arbitrary graph what the dimension could be. But we should think of it just as a parameter which is additionally there. In the case of a Riemann manifold, it's easy. Okay, and then the Baker-Emery curvature at a vertex is defined as follows. So it's a function which depends on the vertex and on the dimension parameter n. And it relates gamma and gamma 2 via this inequality. And as I said, this inequality is a direct consequence that it holds true for n-dimensional Riemannian manifolds with lower Ricci curvature k. But sort of use here this inequality to define indirectly the curvature analytically. So we require that when you take arbitrary functions on my graph, that gamma 2 is bigger or equal to k times gamma of f, and then another term which involves the dimension, and we try to maximize k. And when you do this sort of the maximal k somehow, that this inequality holds true for all functions, and you can, without loss of generality, choosing f of x to be zero as a normalization, then we say that the dimension of the vertex x is this maximal parameter k. Okay, and that's also a definition, and it's a very successful definition, and you have lots of implications which can be motivated by facts from Riemannian geometry, and you can find similar results in graphs. And when you look at this inequality, it's a purely analytically defined inequality, and you can ask yourself, here you want to have an inequality which holds for all functions f. But when you choose a particular function f, just one, then you can ask yourself, what is the value k such that you have here at this inequality equality? And this constant k, where this inequality becomes an equality, is kind of an upper bound on the real curvature, because the real curvature would be the infimum over all these inequalities over all functions. And that means sort of for any function, I give you an arbitrary function, and then you can define an upper bound for the curvature. And when we have this function f, then we call this upper bound k lower n upper f of x. That's this constant where the inequality holds with equality for this particular function f. And now we have to introduce this notion of curvature sharpness. And curvature sharpness is a notion which is still mysterious for all of us. We still think about it, and we don't really understand geometrically precisely what it means. We have lots of interesting facts about it, but we can't really say that we have a full understanding of curvature sharpness. And what is curvature sharpness? Curvature sharpness, we call a vertex n curvature sharp for dimension n. If our n curvature at the vertex x agrees with the upper curvature bound when we plug in for f the distance function from the point x. And you to use this distance function to get upper bounds on curvature goes already back to also paper by Glartag, Kosma, Rally, Tetali from 2016. So we call a vertex n curvature sharp if the curvature, the n curvature, agrees with this upper curvature bound when we plug in this inequality the distance function from our vertex x and try to satisfy it with equality. This gives us this constant kn upper dx, dgx. And when we have kn of x equals kn upper dgx, then we say that this vertex is n curvature sharp. And this is a bit of a strange definition, but that's also a definition which is quite important in our later talk. And you call a vertex curvature sharp if it's curvature sharp for some dimension n. And also we call a whole graph curvature sharp if all its vertices are curvature sharp. So we have these three notions: curvature sharp of n, curvature sharpness of a vertex, depending on the dimension n. Then if it's curvature sharp for some n, then we call it curvature sharp, the vertex, and forget about n. And if every vertex is curvature sharp, then we call the graph curvature sharp. Okay, these are the notions which I want to introduce. And now the question is, how can one calculate this this curvature notion, this Baker-Emery curvature notion? And the idea is that you only need a two-ball. And when you have a two-ball, you want to calculate kn of x, and you only need the two-ball. And you can split sort of, you can partition the vertices of the two-ball to their layers. You can choose x, the center, and then you have the one-ball and the two-ball. And the one-ball vertices we call y1 up to ym. So you can think about all the vertices which are neighbors of x to be enumerated from y1 to ym. And the vertices in the two-ball you call z1 to zn. Okay, and then you can do the following. These gamma and gamma 2, which was beforehand a bilinear operator on a symmetric bilinear operator on two functions, can now be represented at a certain vertex when we evaluate it at a certain vertex, like gamma of f, g at a certain vertex, as a matrix. And this matrix has the size of the one sphere. And you can represent your functions f and g no longer as functions, but as vectors. So you have f is represented by this vector, which collects all values of f on the one sphere. And this other f sub f m plus n collects all values of f on the one sphere plus the two sphere. And using this, we have vectors, and then you can rewrite this bilinear operator as a matrix, a symmetric matrix, and you multiply from the left with fn and from the right with a vector gm. And you can also do this with gamma 2, and you have translated everything into linear algebra. And be aware, so to say, this a matrix gamma and the matrix gamma 2 of x have different sizes. Gamma is a m by m matrix, whereas gamma 2 is a n plus m by n plus m matrix. And one can also write the Laplacian of f evaluated as a matrix multiplied of f of its values in the neighbors. Okay, and then you can reformulate sort of the curvature to be the maximum of all constants k, such that this matrix on the left-hand side is positive semi-definite. So we have reformulated the whole thing as a problem that we have a family of matrices depending on the parameter k. And because this gamma is positive semi-definite, you ask yourself, how high can I push k that I still have positive semi-definiteness, because it comes with a minus sign. So when you choose k very large, you would violate this positive semi-definiteness. And you want to find the maximal k, and this maximal k will then be the n curvature of your vertex. And that's a reformulation as a semi-definite programming problem. Okay, and that's sort of how, because you have software to do semi-definite programming, you can just implement it, and then you can do calculations of curvatures of vertices of any of your favorite graphs. There's also a software which is called graph curvature calculator, and at the end I will show you a slide with some references. And if you want to play around with unweighted graphs for the graph Laplacian, which is maybe the norm, the graph Laplacian without weights, or for simple random walks, then you can play around and calculate these curvatures of vertices for your favorite graphs. But this app doesn't allow you to plug in transition weights, because that would be a little bit too difficult to plug it all in, because it's an interactive app, which is very nice to use. Okay, so upshot so far is we can define a Baker-Emery curvature using the Laplacian and only the Laplacian and the derived operators gamma and gamma 2, which are reformulated as matrices. And we have curvature sharpness if our Baker-Emery curvature agrees with a certain upper bound, which we get when we plug the distance function in the curvature dimension inequality. And when we have for one dimension parameter this equality, then we call it curvature sharp. And now comes the second idea, which I want to introduce, as I said, which originally goes back to David Cushing and to Viola Sikonolfi independently. And this goes as follows. We want to reformulate the semi-definite programming problem up here as an eigenvalue problem, to find the smallest or largest eigenvalue of something, because finding eigenvalues is easier than to solve semi-definite problems in principle. So what we do is the following. We use a concept which is very often used in linear algebra, which has many, many applications, which is called Schur complement. And remind yourself that this operator gamma of x, which can be written as a n plus m, as a matrix, symmetric matrix of size n plus m, that this has kind of a block structure. When you think about partitioning the two ball by the one sphere and the two sphere, and then you have sort of a block of size m by m times m, and a block of size n plus m, and so on. And in the lower bottom here, gamma 2 of x as 2, turns out to be positive semi-definite. And then when you have such situations that you can write a symmetric matrix as a block matrix, where the lower right block is positive semi-definite, then you can reduce the size of this matrix by using the so-called Schur complement, and this is Q of X, and this is done as follows. You take the M by M block, the left upper M by M block, and subtract from M expression involving the off diagonals and the inverse of the lower right block. But the lower right block is only positive semi-definite. For that reason, we use the pseudo-inverse because it may not be invertible in the classical sense. And what is the advantage of these two matrices? Gamma 2 of X is positive semi-definite if and only if Q is positive semi-definite. And you have reduced the dimension to a new matrix which has a size, which has the same size like the one sphere, no longer n plus m. Okay, and then the idea is the following, and that sort of is Fiola Ciccanolfi, and we also David Cushing developed this idea, and sort of we wrote a paper about it together. And the statement is now the following: you start with a weighted graph, and you introduce you introduce a matrix A infinity. So I just want to remind you, Q was the Schur complement of gamma 2. Of a size equals the one sphere around the vertex, and then you multiply it on the left and on the right with this inverse diagonal matrix, where you have on the diagonals the square root of the transition matrix of the transition weights. So if x here is our vertex, and assume we have here transition weights from x to y1 to be 0.3 to y2.2. To y3.1 and to y4.4, then you take square root of 0.3, square root of 0.2, square root of 0.1, square root of 0.4. You make this a diagonal matrix, you invert it, and you decorate your Q from both sides with this inverse matrix and multiply it by 2, and this is your matrix A infinity. And what is this A infinity matrix good for? It's good for because its minimal eigenvalue is the infinity curvature. And you can modify it a little bit also to get the n breaker curvature by subtracting from this matrix another symmetric matrix involving the dimension parameter n. Okay, so what do we have now? We have now a reformulation of our eigenvalue problem as our curvature calculation problem as an eigenvalue problem. And the matrix which we are looking at has precisely the size of the one sphere. And it's not completely far-fetched to think of this matrix A infinity as a kind of a Ricci tensor. And we also have a fact that we can recover curvature sharpness linear algebra-wise, that curvature sharpness is given precisely if this vector V0, which we have on top here, is an eigenvector of this matrix A infinity. And I can also say something about the eigenvalue, so that the eigenvalue is precisely this upper curvature bound. Okay, so we have transformed our definition of curvature into a different word. And now in the third part of my talk, I want to use this curvature matrix, which kind of is a discrete version of the Ricci curvature, to define a curvature flow, which will be an evolution over the transition weights in time. So here is sort of the idea. So we start with a weighted graph, and we have initial transition plus transition weights P0. And for some technical reasons, I assume that all the vertices are non-degenerate. What do I mean by non-degenerate? I mean that this vector V0 of X, all transition weights are strictly positive. For example, this vertex X here would be non-degenerate, but if I would choose from X to Y4 a transition weight from 0, then we would have a degenerate vertex. Sort of the transition, the weighting scheme at the point X would be degenerate. And then obviously you have a problem with defining the inverse of this diagonal matrix V0, but when it can be dealt with. Okay, so we assume for technical reasons that our graph is non-degenerate, and then we look at this vector V0 of X, and in some sense, the geometric meaning of this V0 of X would be somehow the square root of the first fundamental form. So these transition weights are in some sense the square root of the length of a vector in this particular direction from X to Y1. And then the curvature flow looks now as follows. We say that it's described in terms how this V0 at every vertex develops over time. And it's described by this equation V0 prime equals minus the Ricci, this curvature matrix multiplied with V0. It's this differential equation. And we also allow to idleness to or laziness to be constant. And that's the first equation. But the first equation is not so important. So in some sense, we involve this curvature matrix in order to define an evolution of the weights. So the underlying topology stays put, but the underlying topology of the graph stays put, but the weights will evolve in time. And this will be now, because what you can also say is that the values of V0 and the values of P0 determine each other mutually. And so you can also think of it as an evolution of the weighting scheme P of T, starting with the initial weighting scheme P0. Okay, and so one could ask, is there any motivation for this differential equation? And our motivation was a little bit as follows. So if we would take norm V0 square of X, T, and if you would differentiate it, then if you think about the norm V0 square as the first fundamental form and we take the derivative, then we get twice the inner product between V0 and V0 prime. And if we plug this in, we get minus 2 times this matrix multiplied from both sides with V0. And this could be sort of the Ricci tensor. So in some sense, you can think of it that the derivative of the first fundamental form of the metric Riemann metric tensor in T is equals minus 2 times the Ricci tensor. And that sort of should remind us a little bit of the of a Ricci flow in Riemannian geometry, and therefore sort of that is the reason how we came up with this. What's the disadvantage of this definition? And disadvantage of this definition is it's nice, we ran it and we realized that when you just, I dropped this blue term here, we come to this blue term in a moment, but if I just look at these equations involving the red terms, then after finite time, lots of things can happen, it can explode and lots of things can happen. And what's also happening, when you start with a Markovian initial weighting scheme, where you can think of it as the transition weights as transition probabilities, then this Markovian property is not preserved. So this P of T may explode or may go down to zero. And we wanted to normalize it, that sort of this Markovian property is preserved. And we ask ourselves, how can we guarantee this? And it turned out that a very small modification with this correction factor Cx of T times V0 X, T with the right choice Cx of T accomplishes this. Okay, so this is in the next slide. So as I said, if Cx is not there, then the Markov property is not preserved and we may run into a singularity in finite time. And then we do something. We take this normalization vector and we choose this upper curvature bound, which I introduced at the very beginning for curvature sharpness, as sort of a factor which we multiply with zero. And suddenly, by this choice, our curvature flow preserves Markovian property. We called it normalized curvature flow because there's also a notion of curvature, of normalized Ricci curvature flow, where the volume is preserved. But we are a bit of a discussion whether it's the right name. Maybe it should be called conformal curvature flow, which is even stronger. But that's sort of under discussion at the moment, what's the right name for this curvature flow. Okay, and what is our result? When we now do this correction, that we add this term upper curvature bound multiplied with V0, then we have the following facts about this particular introduced curvature flow. If we start with a weighted Markovian graph at the beginning, given by the initial transition weights P0, then the curvature flow determines a whole time continuous family of Markovian transition weights, which are all given by this matrices P of T, depending on the time T for all positive times. And every P of T can be viewed as a Markovian weighting scheme for our combinatorial graph G. And very often we haven't found any example where this is not the case. This Markovian curvature flow has a well-defined limit. So it's not, we can't prove it that it always converges to a limit as T goes to infinity, but all our experiments lead to such a limit. And this limit turns out to be curvature sharp. This limiting weighted graph, which is the original combinatorial graph, but with this limit weighting scheme at T equals infinity, turns out to be a curvature sharp. So in some sense, one can think of this curvature flow to have the tendency to make a graph curvature sharp in the limit. The only disadvantage is that very often the limits are degenerate, have zero transition weights along certain edges, and only if the original graph is highly connected enough, you can then guarantee that the limit also has quite a lot of non-degenerate edges. But I will show this now to you in examples, because now the theory is finished. And the last thing I want to mention with the theory is a little bit of a dictionary, a very rough dictionary between Riemannian manifolds and weighted graphs. So the Bochner identity, using an inequality between Laplacian and Hessian, translates into the curvature dimension formula involving the Laplacian and allows us to define Blake-Rehmel curvature on graphs. The Ricci tensor has a discrete counterpart, this curvature matrix infinity. The normalized curvature flow preserving Markov property, we think it's a kind of a normalization of the Ricci flow, but maybe not the normalized Ricci flow in Riemann manifolds, but maybe the so-called conformal Ricci flow. And the curvature sharpness, we don't really know what the Riemannian manifold counterpart it could be. It may have to do something with Ricci solitons or something, but we have some results, but we still don't really fully understand this curvature notion. And when we have normalized curvature flow in our setting, then it's well-defined for any initial weighting scheme for all times up to plus infinity, and Markov property is preserved along the whole way. And if the limit exists, then the limiting weighted graph is curvature sharp at all vertices. Okay, and now I think I can for the last 8 minutes, I can discuss a few examples with you because the last author of this paper, which we have written and which is on archive about this Blake-Rehmel curvature flow, was Hugo Ben Snodglas. And he's an undergraduate student in the second year, and he wanted some research over the summer, and I told him try to implement this curvature flow with Python, and he did, and then we could use this software to run through lots of examples. So the first example will be a random weighted graph in the spirit of R. de Schreni. The second one will be how do curvature limits look like? What do they look like when we have a path or a cycle? What happens when we start with a topology where every edge is present when we have a complete graph? This is example C. And example D is a nice little example where we glue together complete graphs along vertices, and what you get is what's sometimes also called a block graph, and we look what happens with these weighting schemes on block graphs under the curvature flow. So let me start with the first example. So so here on the left hand side is non-degenerate initial weighted graph, and you see it has 10 vertices from V0 to V9, and you see the transition weights in both directions of each of these vertices, of each of these edges. For example, from V4 to V3, the transition weight is 1, and we don't have laziness, or we have no laziness on the vertices. So usually the transition weights from any vertex to its neighbors adds up to 1. So this is Markovian. And now we run our curvature flow, and the curvature flow as T goes to infinity ends up with a weighted graph on the right-hand side, and certain edges and the limit are no longer non-degenerate. They have maybe one-sided directions only. For example, from V4 to V3, it started with an edge where both transition weights in both directions were positive, but it ends up with a transition weight which is only going from V4 to V3 with probability 1, and V3 doesn't have a positive transition rate anymore back to V4. And you see sort of other red edges which are only one-sided, and then you have dotted edges where both transition weights finally in the limit went down to 0. But what you see here is that there is a highly connected subgraph which is in green here, which is inside this is a subgraph of the initial weighted graph. So this curvature flow tries to find something highly connected in the graph. And this limit here is curvature sharp. So that's somehow what happens, for example, in the case of a random graph. And maybe let me tell you how we produced this graph here. We chose a random adjacency matrix with the Erde-Renisch process. So for any pair of vertices, we chose with probability 0.7 an edge, and with point probability 0.3 no edge. And then we got this graph here, and then we chose randomly initial non-degenerate weighting scheme, and then we ran the curvature flow. And when you have an Erde-Schreni parameter of, let's say, probability 0.3 instead of 0.7, so a small probability that two vertices are connected by an edge, very often the whole limit turns out to be only consisting of red edges and dotted edges, and there's no green subgraph left anymore. So you need sort of a probability of for the Erde-Schreni graphs of 0.6 or 0.7 high enough that the limit is not totally degenerate. That has something which is green. And you see also something about the curvatures. The curvatures of the vertices can be written as a function of time. And what happens usually is the vertex V1 was a vertex in this green subgraph, which is highly connected. And the curvature stays relatively high for such vertices which are still in this highly connected limit. Oh, I have to go forward because it's up here. But when you look at vertex V9, the vertex V9 was a vertex which has no green edges emanating from it anymore. So this is sort of something which is outside this highly connected part. And it is reflected in the fact that the curvature goes down in time. It's much lower than the curvature of this vertex V1. The next example is, what happens if I take a path and choose a random initial Markovian transition scheme, and then let us run. And then the limit is usually that you have these green pairs of edges, and in between you have one-sided edges pointing towards them. For example, when you look at the vertex V5, there you have an edge going to the right, going to this vertex V3, but also an edge going to the left to the vertex V9, and all other vertices have a clear tendency to go to this highly connected subgraph. So these limits are usually as follows. You have some green subgraph, which is highly connected, and all the other vertices have transition probabilities pointing towards this green limit. You can also have, when you have a cycle, then you can also have that the limit doesn't have any green edges. For example, in this case here, the limit for a certain initial probability choice is just a clockwise cycle through your cycle. So this can happen also when you have a cycle and you choose any initial curvature distribution, probability distribution, Markovian probability distribution, that the limit doesn't have such green edges, but maybe is either a clockwise orientation of all the one-sided transition weights or counterclockwise. Okay, now let me tell you about what happens with complete graphs. Here on the left-hand side, we have a complete graph, but we put as an initial transition weights a random choice of transition weights, but they add up to one. So for example, V3 has probability 0.1 plus 0.5 plus 0.3 plus 0.1, this adds up to one. So we have here a choice of Markovian initial probabilities, and we run the curvature flow. And interestingly enough, the curvature flow of a complete graph usually ends up with a simple random walk on this complete graph as a curvature limit. We don't have a proof of it. We have a proof for this in K3 when we have, but we can't do it anymore for K4. But all our numerics tell us that this is the case when you start with a complete graph with n vertices, choosing an arbitrary initial probability distribution, then the curvature flow converges to the simple random walk. And let me finish my talk with this wedge sum of complete graphs. This is a wedge sum of a K4, a K5, an edge in the K3, and you have identified certain vertices to glue them together. And now we can choose an arbitrary initial probability distribution on this combinatorial topological underlying graph, and then you can run your curvature flow. And depending on the probability transitions, Markovian probability transitions you have chosen, the curvature flow will concentrate on one of these complete graphs. For example, if the initial probability distribution was this matrix on the left-hand side, the curvature flow will concentrate at the end on the K5. And all the other vertices have one-sided edges towards this particular highly connected limit. And when you have another transition probabilities, you end up with the K4 as a limit. And when you have a third one here, sort of, then you end up with the K3. So sort of, yeah, the curvature flow here seems to concentrate on one of these complete subgraphs. And so much for this talk. And I want to finish off with a little list of references. So I stop this one here and share screen and show you this one here. And I hope so you see sort of references. So the first reference is a very nice interactive curvature calculator app, which you can use, which is used very often by lots of people to play around with curvature notions. And then the paper where the eigenvalue representation of curvature was discussed is Cushing, Kamtui, Liu, Pyramorph, and Calculus of Variation and PDEs, and independently by Viola, Siconolfi, and Linear Algebra in these applications. And we have written up the theory of this curvature flow in an archive article, which is Baker-Emil Curvature, Sharpness, and Curvature Flow in Finite Linear Graphs, Part 1 Theory. So it has the same title like my talk. And at the moment, we are preparing the implementation part on another paper, which we will also upload in the archive once it's finished. So thank you very much for listening, and I hope you got something out of this talk.
Thank you. So have any questions or comments? Any question?
Is everything so clear, or that you don't have any questions anymore?
Yeah. Hey, Nobot. I'm Bobo.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Ah, hello, Bobo. Yeah. Hello.
Yeah. Yeah. Very, very, very nice talk. A very interesting result. I'm very curious about the theoretical results. So you can prove the limit exists.
That is a big problem. The limits, existence of limits, we can't really prove yet. So we can, the problem is somehow that when you have a graph, there are quite a lot of possible curvature flow, curvature sharp weighting schemes. And where it will converge to, if it's converging, is not clear. And we tried a lot of things, something like, how do you call it when you... something should decrease along the flow or whatever. So far we have no proof that a limit always exists. That's because the curvature flow is a nonlinear differential equation of third, it's very tricky sort of to prove anything. But all our experiments tell us that we have no example. We did 10,000 of lots of examples with lots of random graphs, and it always converts to a limit. So we think that there should be a statement that that this curvature flow always will have a well-defined limit as t goes to infinity, but we have no proof of it. So that's sort of something which we work on, but we don't even 100% precisely know what the tools could be to prove this existence of a limit. We can prove it in special cases, but not sort of in a general setting.
So it's very surprising that for the complete graph, you always converge to the...
Yeah, this is simple random one. Oh. Yeah, yeah.
That's very surprising. Very nice discovery for the rich flow.
And we had the feeling, you know, because this matrix becomes smaller, a size of the one sphere, that this matrix which we have introduced, which David goes back to David and Viola Sikonolvi, this is kind of a discrete Ricci tensor, and it's quite a. And then once we had this interpretation, then it was natural to use this matrix to define a curvature flow. And as far as we know, for Baker-Hamel curvatures, there was so far probably not such a flow. But maybe we are not aware of everything, but we haven't seen anything of this kind. But there's lots of Ricci of curvature flows in discrete spaces in other settings, right, with other curvature notions.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Any more questions? We still have 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I have a question. So, Robert, in application side, we are very interested in finding the community. Like the last example you show, you have like these three different regions. Normally, it looks like a community. So, if I have a certain graph and I'm interested to find out this community, how should I assign certain maybe initial conditions to see if the inner like the clusters or community structures in the network?
So to be honest, I really don't know how you have to put the initial probability transitions in order to end up with the K5 or with the K4 or the K3. What we did is we ran 10,000 times randomness, and we found out that in 80% of the cases of the random transition probabilities, we end up with the K5. And in 10% or 12%, we end up as a K3. And in 8%, we end up as a K4. Mm. So we end up mostly on the biggest. When you choose a random initial probability distributions, then you end up on the biggest community. In this case, with the highest probability, with 80%. But interesting enough, the next one is not the K4, it's the K3. When you choose random initial transition probabilities, K3 has 12% and K4 has only 8%. Of limits. You could always start with a simple random walk on the whole graph, mm-hmm. and then see what happens. Maybe this is a natural choice. Mm-hmm. And I could imagine if you start here with a simple random walk, you will end up with a K5. With the biggest part.
I think in this case, maybe the triangle have higher probability than the tetrahedron, because for the V2, if you add an extra node, move this tetrahedron even further, then the probability maybe go higher.
Yeah, that's quite possible. But usually you would expect that the bigger the complete graph, the more attractive it becomes. Mm-hmm. I agree with you somehow that maybe one can find good justification that there's a little bit higher probability to end up at the triangle than at the K4.
Mm-hmm. I see. Interesting, because I saw that in literature there are some like they use Oliver Rich code to base the flow, and then they still trying to like remove some edges and then identifying some clusters.
But the problem is you need enough edges in your graph. When the original graph doesn't have enough edges, then what you end up with is that all the edges are one-sided transition rates. So all the edges have the property, when you have not enough edges, that you have a transition rate from one vertex to the other, which is positive, and then the other direction zero. And we don't really understand what we should do with these totally degenerate limits, because they appear very often when the original graph is not really connected enough. And we can't increase this the connectivity when we have this graph. So I think we really need originally graphs which are already well connected, and then somehow it will concentrate on a highly connected subcomponent of it. But the whole graph has to have quite a good connectivity already at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. I see. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Very nice talk. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we thank our speaker again for the excellent talk. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.